Welcome to Newsclick. Given the series of anomalous weather events we have seen over the last few years, the narrative regarding climate change has definitely changed in the mainstream media. This is shown by the coverage of the Paris Climate Change Conference that is currently underway. This important conference has a rather difficult objective of negotiating a legally binding and universal agreement on climate change, which is set to involve all the nations in this world. Broadly speaking, the aim is to ensure that emission levels of greenhouse gases are capped so as to keep global temperatures to within 2 degrees above the pre-industrial level. We're joined by Raghu, who is associated with the All India People Science Network and the Delhi Science Forum, to discuss the importance of the Paris meeting and particularly to discuss what it could mean for developing countries like India. Thanks for joining us, Raghu. Now, could you give us a little background regarding the previous climate change meetings we've seen? For instance, the Copenhagen meeting, which is the last big one in 2009, ended in failure. So why should this Paris meeting be any different?
Well, let me begin by saying that although Copenhagen ended as a failure, in the sense that there was a target set at the Bali conference that a solution will be delivered at Copenhagen. A solution did not come from Copenhagen. In that sense, it was a failure, but in view of what has transpired since then, you can actually see Copenhagen as having set the foundation for what is to come in Paris. Okay. There was a decisive shift in Copenhagen away from the framework that has governed the architecture of international climate emissions control agreements, from the Kyoto Protocol, which advocated a firewall between developed and developing countries, which was virtually dismantled at Copenhagen. And at Copenhagen, it was agreed that all countries would do something to tackle the problem of climate change. So while there was no formal agreement at Copenhagen, these major principles in place of the earlier Kyoto principles were agreed upon at Copenhagen, even though informally, and that is what has continued and is expected to form the foundation of an agreement in Paris. Now, why do I expect Paris to be any different? Since Copenhagen, there have been many meetings, each of which have taken a further step forward in slowly, gradually cementing this new framework for a global emissions control architecture, and there is now growing momentum to get an agreement among the public in different countries who have put pressure on their governments, and last but not least, the United States, which had refused to come on board because it objected to a firewall which would place obligations on itself and other developed countries but not on China and India, is now happier with a single framework which it has been pressing for and which now looks likely to be adopted in Paris.
Now, as you've referred to, I mean, these climate change meetings in the past have always been split on the issue of who should ultimately bear the costs or bear the largest share of the costs in shifting from our present fossil fuel-based energy systems, and whether it's fair for developing countries then to shoulder an equitable burden given historical and economic realities. Now, given these, this will always continue to be an issue. What has actually changed in the thinking, particularly in the developing nations, that will allow a negotiated outcome in Paris? Could you tell me about specific things that have actually happened?
And when you say costs, are you talking money costs or are you talking emission reduction as a cost?
Both, and the cost it could have on your economy generally.
I think the first thing is, starting again from Copenhagen onwards, there is a recognition among large developing countries, the so-called major economies or emerging economies, China, India, Brazil, Argentina, countries like that. India is today the world's third largest emitter. China is the largest emitter. So there is an understanding which has increasingly crystallized since Copenhagen that these countries can no longer take the position that we will do nothing. while it was correct for India and China to maintain that the problem is being caused by the developed nations, the idea that developing countries, including large ones like China and India, need not do anything, I think this is now recognized that this is an old position which would have been justified in the early 90s when these negotiations first began, but is no longer justifiable in the middle of the second decade of this millennium, given the size of the economy, given the size of the emissions. However, how emissions can be reduced in these large countries is another matter, and clearly that's the difference between how it reduces emissions and how the developed nations would reduce their emissions. So there is good reason and there is justification for developing countries, particularly large ones like China and India, to take on some of the burden of reducing emissions. However, what is happening now, and I'm sure we'll discuss this in more detail later, what is happening now is that the share of this burden, which we have agreed should be taken up by large developing countries as well, they are, over the years, more and more of the share has been thrust on them by the developed countries, particularly by the US, largely because they themselves have announced or declared or are unwilling to take on a larger share, thereby leaving you to take on the problem, because the US in particular has created a narrative around that if the climate change is going on now, then it's you who are more responsible, meaning India and China, than the developed countries, going by current pollution.
So what exactly is India's position at these Paris talks? And given our massive energy requirements, I mean, Modi has spoken about how, you know, we're going to have to use more coal and so on and so forth. How will the commitments made in Paris actually hamper, or will it hamper, our development trajectory at all?
See, India, as you know, has announced its what are called INDCs. That's the intended nationally determined contributions. That's contribution to the global emission reductions effort. And these are voluntary pledges. And this is what is going to be discussed at Paris. All countries today are placing voluntary emission reduction pledges rather than the earlier Kyoto framework of you know what you want to achieve and then you divide up that burden among the different countries and set quotas. The US, being dead set against targets or quotas, proposed this methodology, which has now come to be virtually universally accepted.
Do you think it will work better?
See, there is a question about which is more effective and which is more pragmatic. Clearly, a top-down target is more realistic. I mean, at least in terms of the goal that you have set and in terms of the science, you know that the atmosphere can take only so much carbon if you want to stay within 2 degrees centigrade temperature rise, which is the openly set international goal. If that's the case, then keeping that in mind, target should be set, which now with a pledge and review system or a bottom-up system, you've got all these pledges, but they don't add up to 2 degrees Celsius. So what you've got today is a set of voluntary pledges, which actually will lead to a temperature rise of more than 3 degrees.
And that's assuming that the voluntary pledges actually adhered to.
So therefore, in terms of effectivity and the science, this is clearly not an adequate system. But because the US would not accept the other framework, because the developed countries also joined the US in saying we also want a framework which places a greater share of the burden on China, India, and others, this pledge and review system is taken to be a more pragmatic approach where you can be more assured of some success if you define success as getting an agreement. And if you don't define success as getting an agreement which meets the requirements of science.
Right. Now, is it feasible for third world countries to wean themselves, I mean, in the short term at least, off their dependence on fossil fuels, which, as you pointed out, are you know, I mean, everyone says that is the main reason why you have such high emissions in developing countries. So are renewable energy sources actually affordable and accessible enough to be used on a large scale? We know that Modi, for instance, has now called upon all sun receiving countries to, you know, join together and work on solar energy, for instance.
There's a two-part answer to this, part of which stems from your previous question, which is, to what extent can developing countries take the burden of these emission pledges that we have been asked to make? Now, India has made a pledge which, to my mind, is moderate in terms of what is achievable, but at the same time, we must realize that there is a finite amount of carbon that the atmosphere can take. The IPCC's fifth report has said that since the dawn of the industrial era, all countries of the world put together have emitted about 3,000 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent into the atmosphere. 2,000 gigatons or billion tons have already gone in, of which 75% has been put there by the US and other developed countries. That leaves you with what is known as a carbon budget of 1,000 gigatons. That's what is left. All these pledges put together now amount to about 750 billion tons or gigatons. That means after 2030, which is when these pledges are tagged towards, there's only 250 gigatons left for all the countries of the world. Mm-hmm. Now that means there is a huge constraint being put on developing countries like India, whose per capita energy consumption and emissions are still one third of the global average and less than a tenth of the US average. We are being constrained to develop, to lift our population out of poverty, to raise their living standards, but all by doing a very low carbon pathway.
Right.
How affordable is this and how realistic is this? One is, as the Prime Minister has said, as China is doing, is our reliance on coal, at least for the medium term, till 2030 or 2035. Now, although the US has successfully managed to paint India as the big villain in this coal usage, in terms of a total percentage of our electricity generation, we are not all that bad. The United States has comparable numbers of 40% odd power coming from coal and thermal sources. So is Germany. So is the United Kingdom have a high coal percentage. So we're not alone in this. And part of this is not just to do with costs. It's to do with what resources you have. The US has oil.
Yeah.
We don't have oil. Okay, so you've got the sun. Now, one is the resources. The other is solar energy today or other renewable sources fluctuate in terms of their production of electricity. With solar, for example, you can't generate at night. And you have not yet technologically built up the capacity to store the electricity because your enormous batteries are required, which are not commercially viable today. So that's one part of the story, which means that you get less, whereas with coal or any other thermal source, you get continuous power generation throughout the day. That's one aspect. The second aspect is fluctuations. Wind, for example, you'll get more in the evening, you get less during the afternoon, you'll get more in the early morning if you're by the coast.
So they're not consistent or uniform.
They're not consistent, they fluctuate, and which also makes distribution and transmission more problematic. So there are both technical and financial restrictions. Financially also, there's a lot of talk about solar energy costs having dropped very low, close to commercial energy from coal. Actually, that's not true, because installed capacity, which is what Prime Minister Modi has been talking about till now, does not translate into delivered electricity. I can have 100 megawatts of installed capacity in solar, but in terms of how much electricity is delivered because of the fluctuations and so on, it may actually amount to only 60 megawatts or so. So the quantum is less, variability is more, and therefore costs will turn out to be high, particularly upfront initial costs. Now the question is, if I'm going to spend that much money investing in solar or wind, that means so much less money for other development activities, infrastructure, poverty alleviation, employment creation, etc.
Now, talking generally, given that the Modi government has been in power for more than a year now, has there been any noticeable change in policy with regard to climate change and the use of renewable resources? Or do you think this is more bluster? Is there actually something changing on the ground?
Well, let me say some things are progressing. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't use the word change, because honestly, I don't think on the ground things have shifted very much. Mm-hmm. The INDCs that India has announced now are more or less an extrapolation to 2030 mm-hmm. of our earlier Copenhagen pledge, right, which was till 2025. And if you extend that curve up to 2030, you will get more or less what has been. So it's not a shift, it's not a gear change, what has happened.
A consistent policy is what.
Yeah, you're more or less following the same route. The big shift that has taken place in terms of announcement has been the solar energy target. The earlier target was 20,000 megawatts. The present target is 100,000 megawatts. There is still a question mark over implementation, question mark over whether we can achieve this number or not. Maybe we can. This remains to be seen. However, I'll just add a small rider that we've got habituated from the present government in hearing rather grandiose announcements, mm-hmm. which we have yet to see translated into delivery, right, on the ground. So I will leave that with a question mark on it, and time will tell whether we deliver on those or not.
Well, so that's, I think, all the time we have today. Thank you so much, Raghu, for joining us. Undoubtedly, we will discuss this issue in the future, I mean, given the sort of weather events we are seeing across the world. Sure. And thank you for joining us on NewsClick today.